Welcome to Tea Time, Conscious Conversation and Organic Tea. I'm Harmony Fronterhouse, and my guest today is Brandon Avolin. Brandon is a former military intelligence Reiki master healer. He's also a paradigm shifter, a fellow wisdom keeper, and also a seeker of the truth like myself. And that is why I resonated with Brandon, and I wanted to connect with him today about sharing some of his stories to empower others through his stories. Brandon, thank you so much for being here today. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely. Today we're sipping on some turmeric tea, and this turmeric tea is, I have a little bit of ginger and a little bit of cayenne, some coconut milk, and it's just a really nice way to wind down at the end of a day. I've been working hard out in the garden all day, and you know, that can make your muscles sore and tired. So I'm drinking on some anti-inflammatory tea. I absolutely adore the way that this makes me feel, and I love the way it tastes too. What are some of the things that you love about turmeric tea?
Well, mine's a turmeric with ginger, but it's just like what you said, a long day. Turmeric is very healing. It's very one of the number one holistic plant medicines out there for healing. And drinking it at night helps soothe and settle the mind, and the all the chemicals and brain waves kind of mellow out and kind of get you ready to deep dive into the astral realms when you go to bed.
Yes, I love that. aspects of it. That's definitely some of the reasons that I connect with it as well. So if you guys haven't tried tea, all the viewers out there, try it because it's really delicious. And some people don't really like that earthy flavor at first, but once you start realizing how it makes you feel, then you start to enjoy it. You know, it's like anything. Like, I didn't ever used to like lemon water when I was young, but I absolutely love it now. And you know, it's just because of the way that my brain has associated it to make my body feel. And so when you start to make those associations, you start to really connect with the healing properties of certain things that you may not really enjoy the flavor of at first, but then you start to acquire that flavor because you understand how your body enjoys it. So definitely appreciate you connecting to turmeric tea because that's one of my favorite go-to, especially in the winter. It's summer now, it's been really hot, but yeah. As you know, a nice warm drink can actually counter that and help cool us down, especially with those anti-inflammatory root herbs, those cooling herbs. When they come from down within the earth, they can help settle and ground that energy, help us to clear anything that's no longer resonating with us, that could get stagnant. Energies get stagnant in our bodies and therefore stagnate our mind and our energy field as well. So those are some of the reasons I love it. And today we're going to be talking about balancing our mind, body, and spirit through understanding the power of will and the power of discipline and connecting to our mission here on earth. Each one of us has an individual mission, and each one of us is here for a reason. And I really appreciate the post that you made on Facebook one day. It was maybe last week. It was on 8/8. That's what it was, the 8/8 gateway. And I've been following the energies of the Lion's Gate for years. And so that actually caught my attention. And then there was pictures of the car crash that you had. And my brother, when my two daughters, so it was about 10 years ago, when my one daughter was little and I was pregnant with my other, my brother was in a severe car accident and he had to have jaws of life. And he was in a coma for a week. And he, like, all of these things that you were talking about really resonated with my experience with my brother. So it really caught my attention. And then I continued to read and was really resonant on your experience, on your near-death experience, your connection with alcoholism, because I also have that in my family. And I was also an alcoholic before I had kids. And so there were so many aspects of your post that really connected to me. And so that's why I wanted to have you on the show. So first of all, I want you to kind of go into your background a little bit and set up the stage for how you came into your spiritual awakening on that 8-8 gateway.
Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah. So like she said, my given name is Brandon. I refer to myself as I am that I am. I'll go into that because this is me. I'm the one and only, just like you. There's only one and only you. You are priceless. But yes, I spent 10 years in the military, military intelligence. I served with other agencies, deployed multiple times to Afghanistan. After the military, I went into low-level law enforcement and corrections. But to rewind, when I was talking about the post, when I joined the military, I come from a military family. My dad was in the military for a very long time and was injured in Iraq. And then I joined the military a year after high school. And alcoholism always ran in my family on both sides. It's a pattern. It's in the DNA. It's in the lineage. Also sexual trauma, any type of addictions, anything like that. You can see the patterns throughout your lineage if you ask the right questions.
Yes,
But in the military, drinking is just a part of their world. I don't associate with that world no more, but it was a part of the world. And coming from a lineage of alcoholism, I was more susceptible to becoming an alcoholic. Well, I joined the military at the age of 19, and that's when I received my first DUI at the front gates of Fort Huachuca. And this is all on my post. I was driving a bunch of battle buddies that were drunk. I was supposed to be the DD. Yeah. But we got on base. I wasn't convicted. I lost rank, but I wasn't convicted. Nothing on my driver's record, nothing. It was just weird. It's just crazy how everything panned out. But it was a lesson to be learned. The universe was saying, stop.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
Yeah.
And as a young adolescent, raging with hormones, and 9/11 happened, and this was in 2005. And you know, it's just part of life. And when you're caged up in the military, and when you have the weekends, you kind of let loose. But anyways, that's neither here nor there. But in doing so, that DUI changed the course of my entire life. That one lesson, it is not a mistake, it is not a mishap, it is a lesson. Everything that happens to us,
yes,
that we frown,
yes,
upon is not mistakes or bad luck. These are lessons for us to learn so we can grow as conscious creators. But that one incident changed the entire course of my entire life. And I have dialed it all the way back to that one instance. So I was already on orders. I was at Fort Huachuca learning my job as a human intelligence specialist and collector, along with other MOSs and acolytes. But I was already on orders to go to Alaska. Well, once that incident happened, those orders went away, and I went to the 173rd in Italy. And that's from the get-go. From the moment I signed the papers to join the Army, I said I was going to go to Italy. I said, that's all I want to go is to Italy. And then I came down on orders to go to Alaska. I'm like, what the heck? No, not saying I got the DUI on purpose, because no one does that. But it just, it changed. It said it was law of attraction. Mm-hmm. I spoke it out into the universe. I didn't control it. Didn't care how it came to me. I had to learn a lesson to get to it, but I got to it. So, but that was my first DUI. And I have no shame, no guilt, none whatsoever. I hope people learn from this. And then I went to my first duty station in Italy, and then I was reassigned to Germany to a special troops battalion. And 2 weeks before we deployed, excuse me, I'm going to grab some water. Mm-hmm. 2 weeks before we were set to deploy, I was on R&R on leave, getting ready to say goodbye to all my family members, saying, hey, I'm going off to combat. And I was in that near fatal car accident. Again, DUI, drinking, driving. I was, everything that I'm saying was told to me because I have no recollection of any of it. None. I literally forgot who I was for a long, long time, even my family members. But lost control of the vehicle, went through, flipped a car so many times they couldn't count. It flipped over 300 feet, almost an entire football field, rolling and flipping and flipping. I was ejected through the windshield a couple hundred feet and landed at a man's front door. My body and my shoes fell off my feet, hit his front door, and my body laid on his steps. And my car flipped through the field into his driveway and went over all his fences. It didn't even touch his fence, but it went into his yard over the fences. It was crazy. I don't know. I have pictures of it. It was amazing. But I didn't feel a thing. But the gentleman said that if it wasn't for my shoes waking his dogs up and his dogs barking, he wouldn't have went outside and looked. And he saw me laying there, and then his dogs took off running after something, and he said it was someone running from the car, but I don't know. That's what he wrote in a police report, so I have no idea. And then my best friend and my brother were looking for me because they knew I was gone for too long. And they drove past the car accident multiple times, and they saw a state trooper come, and state trooper ran up to the scene, and my brother and them, he assessed my body, assessed me. He already pronounced, like, he wasn't able to pronounce me because only coroners can do that, but or medical personnel. But he was to check my pulse and everything. He was like, nope. And then my brother and my best friend showed up, and they jumped the fence, and the police officer said, no, you can't come any closer. And my brother asked if I was all right. He said, no, I'm sorry. And that's when my best friend started running barefooted. Well, not barefooted, but just running instead of taking the car. He ran like almost a half a mile to my parents' house and broke into their house and met my father at his bedroom door with a gun in his face. And he was trying to tell my father what happened. And he said Brandon was in a car accident. And he's like, oh, he must be fine because you're here. And you would never find me. Or back then you would never see me without my best friend, Tristan. He is my right-hand man. And like, I was just at his place today. Like, we can go years without seeing each other. Like, I went 10 years without really seeing him, and then came back home, and we're just like, bam. But, my dad asked him, like, he's fine because you're here. He goes, no, I wasn't with him. And the cop said he didn't make it. And that's when my mom dropped to the ground, and my dad said the F word, and they ran, they left. They went straight to the crime scene. And as a high schooler, I was a volunteer firefighter at the fire department right where I crashed at years prior, obviously. But the first responders in the fire department that showed up was the same fire department, and they knew me. And they were like, oh my God, this is Brandon. Like, holy crap. And they started doing chest compressions, and I was bleeding. I'd crushed my skull. From my forehead to right here is all like all metal plates, and then I had a total left knee reconstruction. But I was bleeding out, and they broke my sternum during CPR, and then they got a faint pulse, so they put me into the ambulance and rushed me into the wake like wake up, Wake County Hospital. And I went through extensive brain surgery where I had 4 metal plates, a bunch of screws, a bunch of hardware in my knee put in. I lost a lot of blood, flatlined a couple times. And when all was said and done, I guess the waiting room, there was a lot of people in the waiting room. And the first words out of the doctors to my parents was, does Mr. Adeline have a will? Cause we don't think he's going to make it through the night. And he pulled my mom and dad to the side. And I was in a, cause of the brain injury that I sustained. I used to speak with a stutter. I used to not be able to walk. Like I'd take really, really, really long pauses trying to find the words. Memory was shot.
Yeah, I can imagine with a brain injury.
Yeah, and it was all the front left lobe. And they were like, well, now it's just a waiting game. So I had people come and shave the other side of my head, and because it was just a massive scar. And I was so swollen, they said I took up the entire, you couldn't see the hospital bed behind me because I was so swollen. And I was on life support and all that good stuff. But little did they know who I was or who I am, because we all have a purpose and it wasn't my time. But when I finally woke up, I didn't know who my family was. I didn't know anything. I wasn't speaking English correctly. Didn't know how to walk or anything like that. But went through 2 days of physical therapy and rolled out of the hospital and cared for my parents. And I stayed there for... stayed with my parents for another 28 days. And then I started gaining memory back. I finally realized I was in the Army and I was getting ready to deploy. And some memory started coming back and it's like, oh my God. And my dad was like, don't worry, your unit, the Red Cross message made it to your unit. Little did I know that they had no idea that I made it through and that I was on my way back. So, that happened in April 2007, and in May of 2000, the next of that May, I went back to Germany and just showed up, and I was like, hey, I'm back. And they're like, what is going on? You're not even supposed to be here. a lot of the last words that they heard was, I didn't make it. So I went through a litany of battery of tests, rigorous tests, because as my MOS in the military back then, as a human intelligence specialist and a cross-training counterintelligence, memory is key. So as an interrogator, you need to remember a lot of stuff. And just being in the military, you have to remember a lot of stuff. And the doctors tell my dad and my family that I won't ever be able to walk again because, I mean, I had total left knee reconstruction surgery. So I was walking with a cane. And they were like, well, you have to pass a PT test. And that's running 2 miles and doing X amount of push-ups and X amount of sit-ups in 2 minutes and a ruck march and obstacle course and all this stuff. And they're like, you have to do this to deploy. And I was like, well, you guys don't know who I am because I made a promise to my dad that I'd wear the exact same combat boots that he wore in Iraq to Afghanistan. So two separate generations. One pair of boots, two separate wars. And I made a vow to my comrades that I'll be on the front lines with them. And at that time, I was taking a lot of pain medication. And that's what got me through it. But also, I was having seizure on seizure medication because the metal plates in my skull were trying to meld together. And it would cause such a pain inside my head that would put a migraine to shame. It would just be a very brunt force of pain that would cause me to drop to my knees and just like stop everything and cry. And it would last about 30 seconds. So they thought it was like seizures. So they put me on seizure medicine and they're like, well, you can't deploy with that. I was like, well, I'm not taking it. I'll deal with the pain. So anyways, 3 months after the car accident, after being, well, by the police officer, not gone, but
you basically coded.
Yeah.
Yeah.
3 months later, I made it to Afghanistan. I passed all their tests. They tried to medical board me out of the military. I had to show them who I am. I don't give up. Adversity, what? Like moving forward. Leave everything in the past because it's no longer here. You just keep moving forward. Energy never stays stagnant. So I literally demolished all their tests. Like, I'm not gloating. I don't do that. I'm very humble. But that was the highest scores in my military career. And I had just gone through the most traumatic injury that this physical vessel has ever gone through. And I bounced back because I remember looking in the mirror, trying to learn how to walk again during physical therapy. And my body, inside my mind, like a voice came over me saying, treat your body as if nothing ever happened. And I was like, oh, okay. And I treated my body as if nothing ever happened. And I bounced back. Like, I tell you, no lie. I wish my best friend Tristan was here.
I believe it.
A week after the car accident, I was in the dance clubs. I was in the clubs. I wasn't dancing, but I was in the clubs. Shaved head, everything. Scar, like, still had the sutures, like, limping around. Because I needed that environment. I had to treat my body as if nothing ever happened. My parents were like, what are you talking about, Brandon? You need to be resting. No, I'm the commander of the ship. This is my ship. This is my physical vessel. What is a vessel? A ship. Mm-hmm. And it does what you tell it to do.
It really does. My brother, like I said, he was in a car accident where he wrapped his car around a tree, had to have the jaws of life pull him out, and everyone thought he had died. He lives on an island, so most people on the island thought that he died. And so many people, you know, were shocked when he came back, and he has plates in his hips, and he was in a coma. And there's just like so many things that are so similar to your story. And he, you know, he was did logging and a bunch of logging competitions and climbing poles, and you know, the logging competitions where you're they're very
on TV.
And he was like the award champion for years before this accident, and his determination, he was like, no, I'm going to compete again. And I think he competed 2 years later and he won the trophy. And you know, it shows you. And then my husband, he's had several different injuries, but the one that I want to mention is he fell, an extension ladder broke underneath him while he was working. And even though he's in martial arts training, his human instinct was to put his arms out, and he broke both of his elbows at the same time. Mm. And the doctor said he would never snowboard, he would never play guitar, he would never be a construction worker, he would never do anything, that he would basically not be able to go back to his old life. And he was like, that was the right doctor, because that's exactly what I needed to hear, because that triggered a drive within him to say, yeah, right, you don't know who I am, you know. And he can now play guitar, he has snowboarded several times over, he builds, you know, he landscapes, he does everything that he could and more. And you know, he has a little bit of arthritis pain if he eats wheat or sugar or overdoes it sometimes, but for the most part, you know, he's a very healthy, able, amazing, you know, person that has defied what medical science has told him is his destiny. You know, he was like, no, my destiny, I know, is much more. I know I can do all these things and more. And you know, he can hold two kids up in each arm, you know, and all their stuff. And you know, he's basically a Superman. And that's what that traumatic situation was the catalyst, like that alchemy that helped you to transform any victimhood, any understanding that you weren't in control, and understand like that you are the master of your ship, that you are essentially Superman, and that we essentially all are that superhero to to the people around us, to ourselves, and, you know, like you said, the I am that I am, that divine essence that's in each one of us that really knows our true potential, even if somebody else on the outside tries to tell us that we're not worthy or we're not able or we're not going to be able to do something one day. And that's something I really connected with. And another thing was the DUI, you know, it saved your life. And that's something that happened to me is I had a DUI back in, I think it was about 2005. And I had been, I think I was slipped a Mickey or either that or just given way too much alcohol in my drink by the bartender or something, because I had two drinks within 4 hours and I should have not had the level that I had. And I should have had, like, from other previous experiences, I was absolutely able and, you know, sober by the
time
end of that.
Yeah, the time duration is long.
And I drank lots of water and everything. And so I felt like I was able to leave. But by the time I drove away and I was in the car and I'm driving down the road, I started to realize that my consciousness level was not what I thought it was when I left. And I started to think about that. And like literally in two more minutes after that, I got pulled over and my friend got pulled over that was following me. And I got a DUI. And I felt like if I would have continued that journey,
gone down
this really dangerous hill and everything, I probably would have crashed my car and died. If I would have continued the descent of consciousness the rate that I was going at. And because by the time I made it to the police station, I don't remember anything. Like I literally was blacked out. And that should not have happened. And every person has a different biochemistry on every day. So it could have just been that. But the fact that I ate food, the fact that I drank water, the fact that much time had gone by, for some reason, you know, the levels were way higher than they should have been.
It was only
like 0.009 or whatever. It was like 1/10 of a point over than the legal limit. It shouldn't have been that high. I should have had much more consciousness at that point. And so I felt like that actually saved my life. And it made me look at how even that little amount could affect me. And so I basically stopped drinking at that point. I did drink at very small amounts, like at special occasions or things
socially.
Like that. Yeah, socially. But then, I mean, even that was kind of socially, I thought, but I was totally an alcoholic now that I look back on it. And then one day after I had my kids, I realized that every time I drank, I just got really silly. And then I fell asleep and I was like, this is not worth it. I have children. Something horrible could happen. And I just absolutely was like, nope, I'm never going to drink again. And I, the only alcohol I've had is like a tincture or, kombucha, you know, very, very, very mild, because you can feel that the separation of spirit with alcohol, because in alchemy, which I study alchemy and make tincture and make different herbal products, things like that, I've understood how alcohol separates the organic matter from the essence of the being, you know. So you've got plant matter and you using alcohol to separate the crude mass from the spirit, from the essence of that. And when we put alcohol into our bodies, it separates that. It separates our divine will from our primal human nature, you know, and we don't integrate that divine will into our existence, into our experience as much. And I think that that's something that is an important thing to bring up for the viewers. And I would love for you to continue on your story. And I only wanted to interject those stories because that's what helps us to realize that it's not just you. Like this is a story that is, you know, it's like that hero's journey that's within us all. And, you know, knowing two people and that have gone through the amazing triumph physically that are similar of what you've gone through and then personally gone through the alcoholism and the DUI and moving through that, it shows that there is potential for everyone and there is, you know, life after death, essentially, in rebirth.
Yeah. All is mind. It's all about literally, when you have the ability to control your thoughts, and you have the ability to identify which thoughts are implanted thoughts, which thoughts are subconscious programming, which thoughts are organic from higher elevated conscious resonance, and what thoughts are from a lower light spectrum resonant. But it's all thought, but you have to clear out your closet, which is your trauma. That was the biggest thing for me. But going back to my story, which was got deployed. Once I was deployed, I was charged with DUI. They couldn't charge me, or they couldn't do anything, because they didn't have jurisdiction over me, the state, because I was a soldier. I was on orders to deploy, and they couldn't do anything. And that lasted over 2 years. And then I finally came back to the States. And when I came back to the States, still in like continuous mode with the courts and stuff like that, I wasn't learning my lessons. Well, during my deployment, once I got to Afghanistan, I was with the 173rd. I was all over Afghanistan, from Bagram to Jalalabad, like everywhere. They even have a documentary on YouTube called The Korngal. It's of my unit, the 173rd. I was in combat. You always tell yourself, like with me, I was like, I'm not going to be one of those guys that get PTSD. Not knowing that my father had PTSD, and he was I had no idea what he was going through, what my mom was going through, what my family was going through when he came back from Iraq, because I had left. So it was like a ricey ride. But once I went to Afghanistan the first time, that was like, compared to my other deployments, that was one of the heaviest ones. I could tell you about my first firefight, not knowing what, like, literally when you get shot at and you're in a foreign country and you're, 19 years old at that time I was 20. You really don't know, like, your training kicks in, but when you hear the bullets flying by your ear and it's just like a whizzing noise and then a crack and then all fire and hell rains down upon you. And you don't have a weapon because you have nothing but a pillow and a blanket in your arms, walk into your tent. That puts fear in you. But I got to my weapon and we went to the wall and we did what we had to do. But the emotions that were not expressed in the moment during those traumatic experiences in combat, we hide, we stuff them down, and we press them deep, deep, deep down in inside of us. Mm-hmm. And we cover it up with medication, pharmaceutical pills, alcohol, negative distractions, bad habits. And that was me. I was the number one guy. And my ex-wife would, she would probably agree to that. And actually she would. But after that deployment, it was something. I would not trade it for the world. I love it. It was amazing because it makes me who I am right now. I was then got back to Germany and then went on to San Antonio, Texas, where I served with the 201st. And there, within a matter of months, I was at a home, a housewarming party, and alcohol was involved. I remember being at the party, and then I woke up in the hospital the next morning with my upper and lower jaws broken. My right eye socket shattered. My mandible separated, my nasal cavity separated from my face. I woke up and everyone was like, what happened? I couldn't talk, so I didn't know what happened. But this was what, 2 years? This was in July 2007. So two years, just over 2 years after my car accident and deployments. But I didn't know what happened. I guess I said the wrong thing to one of the guys at the house that wasn't in the military. He was we call him the civilians, but he was an associate of my buddy. And I guess I said something and he took it the wrong way and he hit me with a foreign object and knocked me out and just kept on pummeling my face in. But anyways, I woke up in the hospital, had to have facial reconstruction. Like all this is redone. Have 6 metal plates in my face, my eye socket here, upper and lower jaws on both sides. Right here, connecting my nasal and my my nasal cavity and stuff together. And then after that, I met my incredible ex-wife. All self-conscious about my new face, I met my ex-wife on Match.com, and that was magical in itself. But perseverance, dedication, I was still asleep. I was not awakened to the divinity and who I am today. Then I was still playing Brandon Avalon back then, playing the game, 3D game, going through the lessons learned and the Groundhog's Day. But I met my ex-wife in San Antonio, Texas on Match.com. We dated we spoke every single day for 2 weeks. And I told her we're not going to go on a date until she feels 100% comfortable. So we spoke every day for 2 weeks, for hours. But we finally met and we dated for 4 months. We eloped, got married. I deployed 4 days later on Valentine's Day, 2010. So our entire first year of marriage, I was deployed back to Afghanistan, doing stuff that I can't really talk about because of it doesn't exist anymore and the people don't exist. So we went a whole year of growing apart and we only knew each other for 4 months. But it was a karmic relationship, a past life relationship that I now know. But we eloped, got married in the courthouse, went to Afghanistan, lost some buddies. Both tours lost buddies, but I lost a good friend of mine. We had about 2 weeks left in Afghanistan, and I had been hand selected to go work again with organizations and individuals that don't exist. And when I came back, I guess my soldier, my buddy, had been getting hazed, and I know he was with me on my first deployment with the 173rd. So I've known him since from 2005 to 2010, up to the moment he took his life. But so I came back and he couldn't make rank because he couldn't pass a PT test because he had a syndrome, some disorder with his calf muscles, and the sheath around his calf muscles wouldn't expand when he ran, when they got hot, and they'd cramp up and he'd fall down. And he'd always been a PFC, and I finally came back and I took over and I told him the next thing I'm going to do is get him promoted. And I worked with him day in and day out on running and just PT, and he finally passed his PT test and he made rank. He got promoted to specialist. I pinned him and it was amazing. And then I was reassigned to another organization. And when I finally came back, he just looked different. And we had about 2 weeks left. I think he's here with me. We had about 2 weeks left in Afghanistan. And I was, the new unit had come in and we were doing rice heat ride. And I was teaching all the interrogators and the source handlers and, you know, those guys, you know, the ins and outs, can't really say it over open line because I'm not going to violate any man-made rules. But I guess he had been getting hazed really bad from his new leader, and like really bad, to where he came into the bee hut, which is just a makeshift plywood shack. And he was in his like full ACUs, pressed, looking sharp, brand new haircut. He shaved because we have beards. We don't wear uniforms in combat. Not my job. We're in what they wear and civilian clothes, and we have beards. And he came in. I'm like, man, why is he in uniform and his beard shaved? I'm not. Like, what's going on? Well, he looked at me, and I could tell that he'd been crying. And I looked at him. I was like, hey, Ryan, you good, man? He's like, nah, can I just have my weapon? I was like, wait, you good? He just looked at the ground. And he's like, I kind of hesitated. But then there was all these people behind him waiting for their weapons. And I'm like, wait a minute. I was like, hey, you want to talk about it? And he said, no. So I went, got his weapon for him. He signed it out, and I looked at him and said, hey, man, you want to talk about it? And I was like, what's wrong? He just said chain of command. That's all he said. And he left, and I followed behind him, and he went into the bathroom stall, and he put the barrel in his mouth and committed suicide. And I couldn't get to him fast enough. But So the entire investigation went through, and I was being investigated because my fingerprints were on the weapon, and I was the last person to talk to him. And like for the longest time, I blamed myself. That was just another thing on top of it's 4433, two master numbers. That's just another trauma on top of another one. But that was something that I took for the longest time until I woke up. But there was a slew of incidences after that led to the right people getting the right reprimands. But I had survivor's guilt because our first deployment together was 30,000 times worse than this deployment. More firefights, more casualties, more trauma, more visuals, more blood, more seeing innocent lives dying. And it's just like, why are we doing this? This is not our agenda. Like, these people are only trying to defend their homes. We would do the exact same thing. If you guys saw truly what goes over there, especially behind classified doors, it is absurd what is being orchestrated upon humanity right now by the United States and all military forces throughout the world. But I took that, I carried that guilt, that shame, like it's my fault. If I was only a better this, if I was only a better that, what if I like stopped and saw the signs and did X, Y, and Z? Well, I wasn't supposed to. That wasn't my divine soul contract with him, because I had a contract with him for this lifetime. And I had to come to the understanding that I was his key home. If it wasn't for me, he would not be where he is right now. He advanced on, yeah, you could have your ideations, your thoughts on suicide. But until you're on the other side of that veil, you have no idea what suicide truly is. You don't know what is in that person's divine decree to self, why they incarnate upon this world. So that's taking their power away from them and shaming them. You don't know their decree to self, to their Godhead. So that is that. And I had to come to this realization because I thought it was very selfish of what he did, especially to me being his longest friend and his like companion and battle buddy. And like, but I had to come to it. Like, I had to turn it inward, and I had to love myself because I helped him. I helped him. He was hurting inside that he was not ready to let people know about. And he was fighting a battle inside his head that if he couldn't talk to me about it, then he couldn't talk to anyone about it. So it was something else that he was battling. And I was that key. And I had to, through my awakening, and I'll get to that part, it just helped me. But so through that, and then I carried his coffin onto the C-130 for his final flight home to Dover Airfield, and where his body was laid to rest in Corpus Christi. Finally redeployed back to San Antonio, Texas. And then I began my life with my wife, trying to start a family, stuff like that. And the universe had other plans. So she went through the first deployment. She kind of knew I had PTSD, but I was kind of denying it at that time. And in February of 2011, I was diagnosed in combat right after Ryan committed suicide. In combat, I was diagnosed with PTSD, go figure. And then I came home, and that was a major adjustment. And my wife at the time said she couldn't go through another deployment like that. She loved me way too much to see me come home changed like I was. Because she knew a different man had come home. And I totally changed my entire career path. So I became an Army recruiter instead of being a high speed, you know, intel operative. I became an Army recruiter. And I was then sent back to Fort Huachuca, where it all began, where I got my first DUI in Fort Huachuca. Now, throughout space and time, I was going to the bars. I was constantly drinking. There was not a day that went by where I was not drinking upwards to 12 to 18 beers just to go to sleep. Now, this was not to party and to have fun. This was to suppress the emotions, the trauma, the hallucinations. I would dissociate. I would literally be talking to my wife and all of a sudden be back in Afghanistan, dissociating, hallucinating. night terrors. So I wasn't doing it for fun. I was self-medicating because my body was telling me, do not take pharmaceutical pills. Do not take pharmaceutical pills because that will totally disconnect you, period. It's bad enough that we have to get vaccinations and shots in the military, but pharmaceutical pills will throw you off the edge. Well, I didn't listen, and I kept on drinking and drinking. And then when I became an Army recruiter, I mean, I was on top of my game, guys. Don't get it twisted. I wasn't some smoke off the, like, some Joe off the block. I was a high-speed soldier. I got my job done. Accolades, stuff doesn't matter to me anymore. But the
common within very high-ranking people that are very functional. So,
And I was very high-speed. I was on my shit. But what, I'm sorry for cussing. I don't really like to cuss, but it was my personal life. Is when I was off the clock is when it got to me. When I hadn't, my hands were idle. That's when it was bad, and my mind didn't know what to do because it wasn't busy. And unfortunately, it never was really physical. Like, my wife would have to watch this stuff, and my I just changed. And me dissociating and screaming at night and waking up sweating, and then alcoholism, and then going through college and all these other courses in the military. And like, it was all coming down on me as a recruiter. And then all of a sudden I snapped. And I remember I was going through the senior leadership's course, SLC, for E7s and master sergeants, and going through the German proficiency award badge, like all this other stuff, and also trying to be a recruiter and dealing with the internal battles and the emotions that were trapped in space and time in Afghanistan, and as a child during childhood trauma and adult trauma. Like, we carry this stuff along with us inside our cellular memory because we're 72 to 80% water, and water holds memory. So I was carrying it along with me, and I, at my breaking point was in February of 2014. I broke, I took my 9mm and put it in my mouth, and I had it. I was done with the voices, the visions, the seeing, the hearing, like hearing my soldiers' voices, hearing like just constant battle like firefights and stuff inside my head, and like literally audible and visual. I was just tired of it. So I attempted to take my life, and Wonder Woman out of nowhere came and wrestled with me with the gun. And I made sure I pointed it away from her, and she got it from me. But I was so in the moment to do it. And she was running away, and she was not allowing me to get the gun back. I put my hands on her, not hitting her, but I was like, give me the gun back. I'm done. And but she gave me enough time for my subconscious mind, my guides, my guardians, me, my higher self to jump in and for something to click. And when it clicked, I dropped down crying. I had no idea what I was just doing. And I was crying and bawling, and I went to sleep. And that was just the snowball effect. My wife was also at that time 4 months pregnant, and I don't blame her for leaving at all. I actually thank her so much, because for her leaving me saved my life again. So I went on. I was in February, and I was going through class, and I get a phone call, and I was called out of class, and it was just a snowball effect, and my wife left me. The ending result was my wife had left me, and I had some obstacles to go through, some lessons to learn, and which I thank her for it. I would not be the person I am today, because it's only through physical experiences and the emotional experiences is how we grow. You do not grow by reading out of a book. You do not grow by hearing it from a lectured person, from someone preaching it to you. You go through it by physically going through it and feeling the emotions. If you do not feel the emotions, you have not learned. And when she left, I thought my entire world was crashing down, and it was. My military career at that point was coming to an end. And she left me on April 1st of 2014, and I was going insane. There was days that I wouldn't eat, I would drink, I'd cry so much to where I'd wake up the next morning and my eyes were swollen shut. But I needed this. This was healing. As much as in the moment it was hurting, it was pain. I was hitting rock bottom. Well, I hadn't hit rock bottom yet, but I needed it. And this was God. This is given. I agreed to this. This was all through consent. I started having more suicidal ideations, especially being alone. So I called my best friend. And at this time I was in Fort Huachuca, Arizona. And I called my best friend, Tristan, back here in North Carolina. I said, hey man, I'm not doing good. And I told him what was going on, and he was in Arizona within 72 hours. He was in the National Guard Army too. So he called his unit. He told his unit what was going on and who I was. And they know who I was. And they were like, yeah, you're good. Go. He got on a plane, flew there. He was there for a weekend. He was there by my side, helping me through it. And when he left, I attempted suicide again. And I called my supervisor and said, hey man, I need to go. He's like, yeah, you need to go. So I volunteered to go to my first mental institution for PTSD and alcoholism. And it's called the Meadows in Arizona. It's not for military personnel, and they don't do nothing for PTSD for combat. It's all for rich, political, high level government officials, like celebrities. Like, I can't tell you who I met there, because of their celebrity status, and I don't want any copyright stuff, but
confidentiality.
But I met a lot of awesome people there that I had only seen on TV. And I thought I was helping. I thought it was working, you know, and I was staying sober and stuff like that. And I was helping through my PTSD, and I was actually finding out about Reiki and stuff like that there. I'm like, oh shit. I didn't know what it was then, as I do now, as being, you know, a Reiki master healer. and teacher, but back then I had no idea what it was. But I was like, it's something pretty cool, and Tai Chi and talking about the inner child and stuff like that. And back then I had no idea what it was about. I was still a non-commissioned officer in the United States military intelligence, and I had a mission to do, and an army recruiter, so I had things to do. But the universe had different plans. So I went there for 28 days, met a bunch of amazing people that I still speak to this day that I've been talking to recently. This was in 2014, from Canada, all over the world, literally. And I got out, I was doing good. I really wasn't able to talk to my wife at that time. We were still married. There was legal litigations going on at that time that were being ironed out through investigations. And I was just trying to stay as strong as possible, stay in the serenity prayer, doing as much as I can, not knowing that it wasn't going to work. So I got out. I was doing good for about a week and a half. I bought a brand new car. And I finally got a chance to talk to my wife for the first time in like 2 months. And it was going good, and then it didn't go good. And I started drinking again. I relapsed. And when I relapsed, it's just the thought, because she's pregnant and me not being able to be there for them. And it just, the situation was not good. It just over consumed me. And I ended up taking all of my antipsychotics and sleeping pills for PTSD. And out of nowhere, I got scared. I already took them, but I got scared. And in my intoxicated state and stupor, I called my supervisor and I told him what had happened, and I passed out on the phone talking to him. I just right there on the spot. Woke up the next day with my stomach pumped and with my soldiers standing right there next to me. Making sure I didn't leave the hospital, because I was about to be headed out to my second and third mental institution back to back, which were in Tucson, Arizona, and Phoenix, Arizona. And then those were both 228 days. And then I went there, thought I was doing good, started doing more Reiki healing and stuff like that, more trauma-based stuff, but it really wasn't working. It was not addressing the emotions. None of it was ever addressing the emotions. Now, from 2010, when I was first diagnosed, 2001, when I first diagnosed with PTSD, all the way up until 2015, to the moment I was out of the Army, I'd been going to mental health weekly, talking to them about what was going on, PTSD and stuff like that. And it wasn't helping. It was not working, because they were not addressing the symptoms and the emotions, only the events and actions. This is where the medical field, psychiatrists and psychologists, all get it wrong. This is where the VA get it wrong. And this is why it is a vicious cycle, because healed people do not make profit. They do not have profit margins if you are healed. Therefore, they only profit off of sick, mental people. Therefore, it's psychological, it's mental, it's thoughts. You are the holder of consciousness. You are thought. You are the beholder of thoughts. You change your thought, you change your world. So going through those facilities, met a bunch of divine individuals. At the time, I didn't know they were divine. I was still asleep. Deep asleep inside the system, inside the game, inside myself, because I agreed to it. And then I finally got out. And when I finally got out, I was on orders to go to the Wounded Warrior unit in San Antonio, Texas. So then I'd be going back to San Antonio, Texas, where my wife and my son would be. But I would never make it. Once I finally got out of my third mental institution, I was sober. I was fine. I just bought a brand new car. I was waiting for my orders to come in so I could pack up my house and all my stuff and move and do the discharge, the medical discharge and everything out of the military that way. That was not the plan. my plan was expedited very fast. I had an associate, a friend of mine that I met through recruiting, going to all these colleges and all these places. You kind of have a network of people. Well, she was at a bar with a bunch of friends and they were intoxicated and they didn't want to drive drunk. So they called me. I had just taken my my medication because I'd fallen into the trap. The doctors said that I have this. So now I think I have this. So now I have to take this medication because I have to fix this. That's not the case, but I was just doing it. So I said, yes, I can help you. Not knowing that my medication was going to kick in as fast as it was. I got to the bar, got in the car as we were driving to her house. I hate when people that tell bad directions and they're like, oh, you got to turn here or you just missed it. Well, that's what she did. And she was like, oh, turn left. And I was like, okay. And I turned left and I hit the curb and destroyed my car. I hit the curb at like 20 miles an hour, popped all the tires, shattered the engine cradle. So we pushed it into the fire department. They're intoxicated. My medication's kicking in. And I'm like dizzy and like, I'm like, oh my God, like something has to happen. The adrenaline's starting to like wear the stuff out. And one of her friends was like, hey, let's just go back to the bar, which was right across the street. So I was like, what else can go wrong? Went into the bar, started drinking. That's what went wrong. Wasn't supposed to be drinking, especially on medication. Bad idea, but what just transpired with my new Cadillac and dealing with what's going on with my entire life, I broke. And it's not you broke, it's you made a decision and you took that path. Went into the bar, started getting antsy, had a couple drinks mixed with medication is not a good idea. Told the female associate, hey, I need to leave. She said, okay, my house is only a mile down the road, we'll walk. I said, okay. She's intoxicated, tripping all over the place. I told her, get on my back. I'll carry you home because I don't want you to fall into the road and get hit by a vehicle. As we're walking, I trip. I throw her over my shoulder. I blow out my knee. She hits the ground. I can't walk anymore. She's highly intoxicated. Alcohol and the medication's catching up to me. I'm coming in and out of consciousness. She's like, don't move. I'm going to go get my car. I'll be right back. She goes, gets a car. My car keys are in her purse, in her car. While I'm sitting there waiting on the curb, I pass out and a police officer, I guess, pulls up, finds my body and calls the fire department. All the police show up. She finally pulls up to the scene, runs up to me, telling the police officers, don't worry, he's okay. It's just his medication kicked in. They pull her off to the side. They find out, you know, that she'd been drinking. She failed the sobriety test. She gets charged with DUI. They find my car keys in her purse, in her car. My car's down the road, trashed. So they're like, well, what? I was then charged with 4 DUIs. I woke up in the hospital the next morning, the same hospital that I kept on waking up in Fort Huachuca, handcuffed to the bed. And the police officer asked me if I was driving last night. And I said, no, I was walking and I was charged with 4 DUIs in Arizona. If you're 0.08 and below, or like 0.07 and below, you could still get a DUI. It's called the Just Cause Act. So I got a 0.08, 0.1, 0.2, and I 0.3. So that was 4 DUIs because at each code or each level I broke. So that was the end of the straw. The military was like, well, you just got hit with 4 DUIs. And the other DUI before that was dismissed. It was thrown out. I don't know how. It was all of them were thrown out. And then this one came up, and that was the end of it. Expediting me out of the military under honorable conditions. All 4 DUIs were thrown out and dismissed. They never went to court. I was never in a car. The police officer, it was just this craziness. But it was me losing everything. Not losing. You never really lose anything. It's transcending. It's It's evolving beyond, so you can awaken to something else. But I hit rock bottom. 2 suicide attempts, 6 DUIs, my military career, 10 years gone, not gone, but evolved on. Going through a divorce. At that time, I was served with divorce papers while I was being transported to my third mental institution. So while I was in the hospital handcuffed to the bed, I was also served at the exact same time in front of the police officers. So, and the whole time my wife was saying we weren't going to get a divorce, but it is what it is. Thank you. I love you unconditionally. So got out of the military. I had no idea what the heck I was going to do, but I knew I had to support my son. But I had to fix myself. I'd been sober. My last drink of alcohol was 8/8/2014. That was the last time I had ever touched a drop of alcohol, and I will never touch it again. Even though I've had individuals try to get me to drink, no. Just because of the chemical and alchemical reaction that it has to the divinity, the connection, the dilution it would have on the Antakahana, which is also known as the Rainbow Bridge. The connection of the higher and lower mind, the spirit body, the full embodiment and activation of the Christosophia, the crystalline body. So going through a divorce, unwanted divorce, but I will not infringe on anyone's free will. So I get out of the military. I went into law enforcement as a correctional officer at the state penitentiary here in North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, where I was there for 9 months. And I mean, during the entire time when I got out of the military, I submitted for a fire department, got accepted, but turned it down, got accepted to Raleigh Police Department, got accepted, turned it down. I went into interviews with the 3-letter intelligence agencies, turned them down because something inside of me just didn't feel right. Like this was the beginning of the crack of the egg. Like when I was offered a DEA job down in Tampa, Florida, like I didn't go because something in me was like, no, this isn't you. So I went corrections. And when I went corrections, I got to see inside the prison system and inside the law enforcement system, all laws, everything. And I was there for 9 months seeing suicides, murders, like inside the jail. It's crazy, inhumane. The living conditions and standards, like some of these people are innocent. Our justice system is very, very flawed because it is a corporation, because it falls under the HJR 192 Act. Therefore, it is a corporation. It is flawed. It is only there to feed. Yes, it's only there to feed itself, which is a green machine profit. And I saw buddies that I went to high school with, and they're in prison, and they're like, wow, 2 different paths. He's out now. He got out on my birthday on a manslaughter charge, vehicular manslaughter charge, because of a DUI, but he got out of it. Like he went to prison for like almost 2 years on a 25 year sentence, and he got out. Mm-hmm. Something like, he was already on a 25 year plus sentence, and he got out in 2 years because his mission was to go and see what it was like to be in prison, because what he was convicted of was false. He was convicted falsely. So it's karma coming back on his side. But he needed to feel that experience, what it would be like if he really did that again, because prison is no joke. And he told me when he got out of prison, he contacted me. He said, hey, man, when I saw you for the first time, I wanted to throw you in the closet, beat you up, and take your uniform and your gun and stuff and walk out that prison and get in a car and just drive off. And I told him, man, if I know what I know now, I would have let you out regardless, brother. Like the stuff that goes on inside those prisons, it's not just the prisoners, guys. Don't get it twisted. it's the system and the personnel. Like, it's corrupt through and through, from the government.
It was like you were doing your own time, you know, like even being an officer, you were still doing time, you know, and it's like that universe's way of saying, look, you really got to learn your lesson this time.
Yeah.
It's like the side of the soul, right?
Crazy. So I knew that it wasn't for me. I was being called a racist, knowing we have a multiracial family. So we don't see color. We see soul. We see aura. That's what we see. We see the star system in which you came from. And that's how my family operates. And I had this fire burning inside of me that just wanted to help people. Because I did not go to war multiple times to come home to fight another war with my own government. Like, what? Why are there children and homeless? Why? Why are there people going hungry when we spend trillions on bombs, bullets, and spacecraft when we've never been out there? Oh, it's an illusion. But it's part of the game, guys. It's all part of the game.
Crumbling.
Yeah, and it's all crumbling down right now. So got out. I applied to college to finish my third degree, because degrees don't mean anything. Seriously, they don't. I went to NC State for sociology and anthropology. I was there for a semester. I was like, man, what? They're teaching these kids in like sociology class. They're teaching these kids that a white female and a black female, same credit score, same job, same everything, can go into a bank, and that black female is going to get a higher interest rate straight off the bat because of the laws that are still on the books and what we operate, or like the banks still operate on old laws on the books. So, and I'm like, you are teaching these kids this, and the kids are just absorbing it. Like, is this going to be on the exam? I'm like, wait a minute. You're telling them that the system in which they are living in and under is still segregating people by race, the financial system.
And instead of saying, wait, I'm questioning it, they're all just regurgitating it out.
Exactly. And I was questioning it and questioning it and questioning it. And my professor did not like that, because I was like one of the oldest people in there. And with my life experience, I was just watching these kids just eat this up. And I was like, wait a minute. Why are you teaching these kids this? All they're going to do is go out there and regurgitate it and recycle what you're teaching them, which then furthers the stagnant energy in which we're living in. And then even in my class, because I love all religions, because I see them as puzzle pieces. I don't take them literal. Yeah, I love knowledge. So I took Islam. I lived in Afghanistan. I literally lived with the people in Afghanistan. I speak the language. I know Pashtunwali, Islam, the Muslim culture. I know it. So I went into college. I went and took a class. And it was all they taught was war. Muslims fighting this, doing this, war, 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 war. And I raised my hand and I challenged that professor every step of the way, because I was like, wait a minute. You can't tell me, because I lived with them. I wasn't out there on some scholarship, doing some college thing, getting my doctorate. No, I lived with them in a combat zone with their lives on the line, because they're harboring me, an infidel. So you are preaching false. And a lot of the kids in there were Muslim too. And they're like, yeah, what? Like, no, we're not like this. Like, this is the United States indoctrinating system. This is why we keep on repeating history, because we're teaching the past. The past no longer exists. You learn from it, you make corrections, and you drive forward. That's it. Cut ties, attachments, cut sling load. That's it. Yeah, I love knowledge. So I took Islam. I lived in Afghanistan. I literally lived with the people in Afghanistan. I speak the language. I know Pashtunwali, Islam, the Muslim culture. I know it. So I went into college, I went and took a class, and it was all they taught was war. Muslims fighting this, doing this, war, 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 war. And I raised my hand and I challenged that professor every step of the way because I was like, wait a minute. You can't tell me because I lived with them. I wasn't out there on some scholarship, doing some college thing, getting my doctorate. No, I lived with them in a combat zone with their lives on the line because they're harboring me, an infidel. A lot of the kids in there were Muslim too. And they're like, yeah, what? Like, no, we're not like this. Like, this is the United States indoctrinating system. This is why we keep on repeating history because we're teaching the past. The past no longer exists. You learn from it, you make corrections, and you drive forward. That's it. Cut ties, attachments, cut sling load. That's it. So I was like, oh my God, I can't take this. I can't take this anymore. Like, I never studied. I didn't hand in any tests or I didn't hand in any work, nothing. I failed all my exams and I still passed. I passed with, I want to say a 3.1. And I went to my professors at the end of the semester in December of 2016. And I asked them, why did they pass me? Because like my papers and stuff. Yeah. Like I obviously I do like papers and stuff, but like I'd fail my tests just because I know what was really going on. I was starting to see through the illusion that it was all about monetary gain and it was not about education. It's about indoctrination.
Yeah.
And I told them this and they were like, that's why we passed you. That's why like they were like, you are a philosopher.
You
are beyond this. And when they said that, I had no path and I dropped out of college. And on December 16th, 2016, I woke up. I attempted my third suicide attempt right here in front of me. My path had ended. I'd done all my exams, got my transcripts. I was like, what? I passed. Okay, whatever. And I had nothing. Nothing. I had no plans. And coming from a military family, being in the military, being in law enforcement, everything, bam, 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 I had no path. And my mind was racing again. And then at this time, I was still going to the VA, taking all this medication. At this time, I was taking upwards to 18 different types of medication for my PTSD, my sleep apnea, for my dissociations, my everything, you name it. Anxiety, general, social, manic depression, all of it. And I still made it in law enforcement. So something was working, but I was still on the medication and all of a sudden right there, just the ideation of me committing suicide, just the thought of it, because I thought I'm done. I had nothing to, nowhere to go, nothing to do. I just left law enforcement, not going back to that. Just left college because that's fake. That's a farce. What do I do? And the moment that it popped in my head, I had a spontaneous Kundalini awakening. I closed my eyes and I didn't say God. I said, what do I do? Who am I? What am I supposed to do now? And when my eyes were closed, the biggest flash of white light engulfed my entire reality. It literally like permeated through everything inside my being, inside my body, into my reality. It was like the Big Bang. And I went to bed that night. And the next morning when I woke up, I saw colors. I was feeling so high. Like my body was vibrating. My organs were shifting. My body was like losing weight. I couldn't eat meat anymore. My body was not digesting meat, processed foods, no coffee, no milk. Nothing. Well, not coffee, but no milk, no soda, no dairy, nothing. Only water, black coffee, vegetables, and fruit, and peanuts. And that was it. And I went from almost 200 pounds to 132 in 2.5 months. My body was vibrating. My chakras were starting to open up. My third eye was waking up. but I was going through the dark night of the soul. And when I was going through the dark night of the soul, all this information was coming into my body and I had no idea what was going on. I would go to sleep at night and my body was shaking, shaking and vibrating, 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 just like this. And I'm just like, what is going on? And I'd finally fall asleep, but I wouldn't fall asleep. I'd go off and start, I'd be somewhere else working. And then in the morning time, I'd come back into my body and I'd be totally exhausted. Mm-hmm. But I have so much of information, so much knowledge, agnosticism, esoteric knowledge, coordinates, events, revelations, visions. I'm like, what is going on? I'm going crazy. I have to go back to a nut house. This is why they sent me to the nut house. I got to go back to the nut house. And I was asking my sisters and my family members, like, am I going crazy? And they're like, no, man, you're not going anywhere. You've always been crazy. And I'm like, no. And then I started losing all this weight. I wasn't exercising. I wasn't doing anything. And then I went through my dark night of the soul. I literally, I was guided to start doing meditation. I had no idea what meditation was. No idea what meditation was. But just lay down to Tibetan style, because in the Tibetan style meditation, to lay down. So I started laying down and just closing my eyes. And then all of the emotions from combat, from childhood trauma, from sexual trauma, from divorce, everything, all of it came at once. All of it. My entire life came crashing down in an instant. And the only way from there was up. I saw every single traumatic experience and relived it again, not through my eyes, but through the eyes of the person that I had offended and hurt in meditation. Now, during meditation, I was trying to come out of it, but nope, my guides and my ancestors were like, nope, go back. And they kept me in. This lasted for months. There was days that I'd go crying and days that I'd go laughing, days where I would go silent, times that I would only go downstairs to go to the grocery store and come right back home. For 2.5 years, I did this. I'd only go to the grocery store and come back home, grocery store and come back home, right back up here, right back into meditating, sound frequencies, and time travel. Mm-hmm. I was going every single event and I felt the pain. I felt the pain that Ryan was feeling when I handed him that gun in Afghanistan. But it wasn't the pain. It wasn't pain that I was inflicting on him. It was pain that was inflicting on him from outside of him, but I was helping him release himself from that pain. And that was my divine contract with him. And so his last name is the same last name of the female that I was ejected out of my car when I went through the car windshield of my car. I was following behind a female, and that female's last name is the same last name. I went to high school with her. Her last name is the same last name as my soldier, and they don't know each other. They're from two different parts of the world, but their name are the exact same. Crazy. Now, yeah. And it's gardener. What is a gardener? Mm-hmm. A gardener does what? Plant seeds. What else does a gardener do? Harvests.
Mm-hmm. Tends the weeds.
So, wow. And another battle buddy of ours, mine and Ryan's, was another buddy, Evan, and his last name was Gardner. But Ryan didn't know Evan, but they both knew me. And then Evan Gardner didn't know Ryan Gardner, didn't know Anna Gardner, but they all knew me. And they were all from different parts of the world, which is crazy. But Anna Gardner, I killed myself literally following her. And then Ryan committed suicide after me helping him. And then I'll get to Evan Gardner in a second. That's where my spiritual awakening comes in. I've always known Evan. Evan was counterintelligence. He was a counterintelligence agent with me. We were sister MOSs in the military. We go back to 2005 also. So where was I at? I lost my spot.
So you were talking about essentially that dark night of the soul where, you know, where we have that moment where we realize that everything happens for a reason and that, like, you lose that guilt, right? You just kind of start shedding off those layers of the things you no longer need. And then you were talking about the time travel, like being able to, you know, go back into the different places of different where the other people had experiences and find that compassion.
Yeah. And I talk about this stuff on my YouTube channel. Also, I have my own healing videos that I've done. I give my own story and stuff like that, but that is also on my YouTube channel. But dark night of soul, feeling like literally feeling their emotions, crying in hypnosis, in meditation, like coming back to after feeling that, healing it, having the knowledge that I have now and taking it back in my time machine, back to that time and space and healing that moment, healing those emotions, giving myself a hug with the knowledge that I have now, lending it to me, saying, hey man, everything's going to be okay. This is why it happened. And then looking at my friend Ryan and saying, hey man, I love you and it's okay. I let you go. I have no guilt. I know why we did this.
Yeah.
And to, you know, the enemy on the battlefield and all my, and my other buddies, the one Ryan stuck with me because I had my hand in it. Like my hand touched a gun, like, and I was the last one to talk to him. And, but going back and feeling those emotions, but it's all of our events differ. All of our traumatic events differ. But what stays the same are the emotions. The emotions will never differ from each other because pain is pain, love is love, shame is shame, guilt is guilt, but the events change. Mm-hmm. So it's not, you cannot change the event, but what you can change is how you embrace and release that emotion in that space and time. And that's what I was doing. And I had no idea what was going on, guys. My human mind was like, dude, you're crazy right now. Why are you meditating? And then my higher self, my other side of my mind was like, bro, just go with it. Tell that other guy to get the back of the bus and shut up. And there was a battle going on inside my body. And it was reflecting on the outside reality. And instantly, when I started healing myself, all the medications were gone. The moment I healed my traumatic experiences in combat, all the pills disappeared in one day, just like that. All the symptoms, all the hallucinating, the memories, the dissociations, all of it gone. It was amazing. It was
it's really crazy. Incredible. And it just like opens up that like a whole new space for like your true divine will to come through, you know. And that's part of something that I connected to that you were talking about, is that the dark night of the soul, and when seeing all of those ways that you view the past, right? The ways that we saw ourselves as victims, and start to shed those layers of the onion and start to get down deep to what the core of who we really are is. And that is, you know, like you said, compassion and unconditional love, and understanding that these people that have harmed us or that we thought were situations of trauma, we can actually find compassion for the trauma mm-hmm. that they went through that triggered them to be an abuser themselves, or however that may work. And I wrote a book, Birthing a New Paradigm, and I talk about that a lot, about how I go back into my old memories and rewrite them. And that helped me find healing through that transformation of alchemy into the world that I see now is a whole different place. I no longer live in that victim mentality. You know, I no longer blame others for who I am or those choices that I made. And I take full responsibility. And I think that that's what you're talking about here. And I think that, you know, that it changes things exponentially. It changes our DNA. It changes the ancestral trauma that we're holding on to. It changes the ancestral trauma that we're passing on. We no longer have to pass those things on to our children. Mm-hmm. And I talk about all that in my book. So I love that you're bringing that up and that that's something that you connect to as well.
Oh, we're going to have another tea time, because I have quantum healing sessions. I have a grid work going throughout the entire world, from Ireland to England to Australia to Egypt to Tibet, doing grid work, going and healing that land. I had no idea what any of this stuff was prior to my awakening. It was the exact 180 opposite, like Jason Bourne, military, like that stuff, killing, that was it. That was ingrained in us, programmed into us. Mm-hmm. And I had to deprogram that from me. And that's where my awakening came in. And then Dark Night of the Soul, I felt their emotions. And then I had to relive it again. And then again through my emotions. So I felt their emotions and then my emotions. And after my Dark Night of the Soul, I wrote so many amends letters and emails and phone calls, as many as I could freaking think of. Did I receive confirmation back from all of them? No. But I made the effort. I forgave myself. Therefore, that's all that matters.
Yeah, it is.
As long as I stood up, I put it out there. When I wrote my amends letters, I didn't write my amends letter saying, you did X, Y, and Z. No, I wrote it, you did this right by me. Thank you for this. You did this. Amazing. Thank you. This is what I did not see. And for that, I love you.
Right.
And you want to, like, I want to uplift them and tell them, hey, I didn't see this, but this is what you did so right by me. And I apologize. I hope you can forgive me one day. And if not, I hope you the best in your future endeavors. And once I did that, my body was changing. I literally lost 74 pounds in 2.5 months. My diet changed. Now I don't really eat. I'm starting to become a breatharian now. I went from eating meat to being a vegetarian, to being a vegan, back to vegetarian, a fruititarian. And now all I really do is drink water. It's like a really, really, really long fast.
Yeah.
A water fast. But that's the crystalline evolution. That's where our DNA is starting to change and our body starting to change from a carbon base 666 to a crystalline base 14.
Absolutely.
So
that's where tea comes in, you know, because
yeah.
I joke around with this the pending food shortage that may occur, and I say, you know, well, I have enough herbs to, and you know, all the garden herbs that I harvest and preserve to have tea to last my family, you know, for years. So, you know, we could live on tea. And I think, you know, if you look about what food is, and it's essentially a energy exchange, right? It's a way to transform one form of energy into another. So if you can learn to do that without the actual food and still get the chi, get the prana, the energy in the form of light or the form of breath or the form of, you know, however that works for the each individual, I think that that's absolutely, it's founded, you know, like people have done this for centuries. And I find myself doing that as well, like throughout the day. If I didn't have children, I'd probably fast most every day, but it's them reminding me it's time to eat that makes me go, okay. And then I taste it, make sure it tastes good. And, you know, and I joke around, you know, I'm constantly trying to put on weight because my metabolism has, you know, become so fast. And after I had kids, I was also about 200 pounds I almost had a diabetic coma. I almost died, and I had a near-death experience when I got really sick and had acidosis in my body from eating too much sugar and all these things. And so I absolutely had an awakening through, you know, what we have to eat and what sustains us and the reason why we eat. And, you know, all of those awarenesses came upon me within a very short period of time. And that was part of my awakening, you know, back in in that time of suffering. And I think that suffering does, it's like a catalyst to awareness and awakening into greater realms of reality, you know?
And, oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. When you deprive the body of outside energy, it has to use its own laboratory, because our body is literally a temple.
Yeah.
It is our alchemical laboratory. And being a human that is 80% void, because the human body is made up of 72 to 80% water, and water consists of three atoms, and those three atoms are consist of 99.99% void. Therefore, the human vessel is 72 to 80% empty void. It is what you feed it. It's what you talk to it. It's how you express yourself. It's what you listen to, what you watch, how you speak to yourself inwardly, what you consume food-wise, because food does have vibrations. And the highest vibrational food is that of seeds and light. Light is the highest, but seeds, and then you have fruits and vegetables. And then at the very bottom is obviously meat, because meat is it automatically starts decaying once the animal dies. And everything is energy. So if we're energy and we're putting something that starts decaying into a live body, then our body has to start conforming to that energy. Therefore, it starts taking time off our life cycle.
Yeah.
So if you start eating food with life force that comes from the ground, that is seeds, that's not GMO, like fake the tomatoes and stuff like that. I saw one for the first time today. Ridiculous. But I just found out, like, most fast food restaurants, like, I don't eat fast food, but today was like, I needed to put some vegetables in my body, and a lot of places are requiring masks. I will not wear a mask. I'm not a slave, and I'm not a sheep, for I'm not looking for a shepherd. I'm my own God. And there was only a place that, like, the grocery stores are like, how can you stop a human being from the basic necessities because they're not conforming to someone that doesn't have authority over them?
Well, PTSD is 100% medical exemption.
Oh, yeah, but...
Yeah, but they don't care.
And no, that's they don't.
That's the ridiculous part when people start to... They're like, I'm wearing a mask to protect you. You're wearing a mask to protect those who can't wear masks because they have medical exemptions. Hello, so stop judging and start loving and start uniting. And I know that like with PTSD, the masks are a real thing, because I know somebody personally who has a very, very hard time seeing people in masks because it brings them back to combat.
Yeah. Well,
right. So, you know, not being able to see anything but this can be very triggering to people. And
I can understand that. I can.
PTSD, and I talk about this in my book. I was attacked by someone in a ski mask, and almost gagged and bound and put in his trunk. And the masks are a very triggering thing for that. And it's something that I'm working through, and I know that it's being presented so I can work through it.
Yeah.
And same with the other traumatic one, another one of the traumatic times in my life was in the medical system. And it was a forced surgery on me, and there was a lot of trauma around that. So, you know, there, besides, you know, having asthma and other kinds of issues that may be a medical exemption, I totally agree with how you're connected on that level of the masks, because it's something people need awareness about how it can be helpful if you want to wear one, but it should not be a mandatory thing. And
no, absolutely not.
Our immune systems and all that is a whole nother talk. So yeah.
The whole mask thing is a whole different talk.
Yeah.
You guys want to, if your subscribers want to see anything about that, jump on my Facebook page. I give you keys, laws, unalienable rights, laws, case laws, Supreme Court cases. During my awakening, I dove deep into laws, universal laws, everything. Like, taught myself legalese. I taught myself Greek, Latin, so I can better understand their rules and their games, so I can find the codes to play. So, because if you don't know the rules or the codes, how can you play their game? Well, they spent millions of dollars on my training, and I'm going to use those attributes and skills for the people instead of for the military complex, the deep state. I'm going to use it for we the people.
That's why you got all that training, you know? That's why you were asleep for the time that you were getting it. And so you could utilize it now. And, you know, I think that's why a lot of movies are, you know, like a lot of people watch a lot of movies. They give us a lot of clues, you know, and in movies, they tell us like the keys to how to do things. I can't remember the name of the movie, but it was like an apocalyptic movie. And there was this part where there were these people and they were trying to evade these soldiers, and they had figured out like the rift and they were invisible. And the minute that they realized that the soldiers couldn't see them, then they realized that they were invisible, and even though they were standing next to each other. And then something happened where one of the characters that was invisible started to go into fear, and they dropped their frequency, and then all of a sudden these soldiers could see them.
That's reality. We could do that here.
Yes.
And that happens here.
That one really resonated with me. And I feel like I'm seeing that in so many different layers throughout this reality. And then like with Peter Pan and Happy Thoughts, and that gets you to fly. You know, there's all these different little keys and all these things within reality that really help us to understand those underlying threads that make it easier for us to walk through this journey and activate us in our DNA, show us our potential, show us what determination and divine will can do, you know?
Oh, man, you want to know what divine will and determination get you? I don't have a driver's license. That's a contract. That's a contract with a corporation on the United States, under the United States and the state. The state is a corporation. That is a contract, driver's license. When I woke up, I turned in my contracts. Voter registration, turned it in. Driver's license, turned it in. Insurance, turned it in. Any contract that you have with the state, you're their employee. You are their corporation, which is tied to your uppercase name, which is tied to the Federal Reserve, which is tied to the Treasury Department, which is tied to the Crown, because the Crown of England holds copyright over every single corporation under the United States. We never succeeded in 1776. They only told the people that we did. We only became we became their babysitters, because being in the military, no, you do not go to war and not leave an influential party there to turn their tides. The same thing happened in 1776. Christopher Columbus was on here on a mission. What they were looking for was a lineage, a blood lineage. They were looking for an Akashic records that descended from the fall of Atlantis, also known as the tribe of Dan, Theotha de Duadan. It's the tribe of gods that came from Atlantis and Lumeria that hold certain codes inside their DNA. And 23andMe and all these Ancestry.com corporations work for the CIA, work for the government. And what they do is they take your DNA, they read your Akashic records, they go into quantum. No, they don't. It's all, now your stuff's wigging out. Everything's wigging out.
Ancestry.com is where you got cut out.
Yeah, so they go, what they do is they go in, they read you, they're looking for a certain set of codes, tones, codes, and Akashic records, books, a library. And what they do is they give you a pie chart. But if it wasn't for your consent, anyone that is outside of you needs a warrant to get your DNA. Why is that? Why is that? Now, if they have your consent, you now just sent them your entire book of life, your mitochondrial DNA that goes back 80 generations. That what they're looking for is the mitochondrial DNA that you only get from the mother. It is the mother that they are trying to suppress. The feminine power, the feminine energy is being suppressed and has been suppressed, but not anymore, because she's awake. She is awake. But
the human rest,
that's the whole thing. Yeah, that's the whole DNA. That's what they're looking for. That's why Christopher Columbus came over here. It's all Freemasons and all that good stuff, but that's a whole different story, whole different. Yeah, and that's quantum healing. That was one of my past lives when I was in a hypnosis session. I talk about it on my YouTube channel, but yeah, literally hitting rock bottom, putting a gun in my mouth, taking all my pills, attempting suicide, losing, thinking that I lost everything. Because everything is a thought. I became a lost boy. Therefore, I was the closest to being found.
Yeah.
Because Peter Pan and the Lost Boys, we're going to Neverland and we're going to get Hook and that alligator that has that clock in his mouth. And because the clock is what's holding us down is time. Because if there's no such thing as time, then we are everlasting. So once we get rid of this construct, this paradigm, this inorganic way of being, as we elevate, I mean, everything's going to change. Everything's going to change. Sorry, I kind of got off on a tangent there.
No, that's the real deal right there, you know. And, you know, through, like you said, the activating of ley lines and activating of our DNA, you know, all those journeys that you went through and activated different places around the world, even through, you know, combat, those were sacred places that you were supposed to be with your feet on the ground at that moment, you know, and you were activating things. And, you know, this could be a whole nother show as well, as, you know, laying down crystals and activating ley lines and grid lines, because that's something that I connect to and have for at least a decade, and my kids do as well. And when I was a child, the crystals would tell me certain things to do, and I wouldn't even understand why I was doing them. And now, as my consciousness has grown and I've understood certain things through other people's affirmations, I'm like, oh, okay, so that's why I was doing that, and this is why that was happening, and oh wow, I didn't even realize why I was instinctively driven to do certain things. And then when you start to understand why, then you're like, wow, this is a really amazing ride we're on, you know? And this is very profound, our interactions with this world and with our realities. And if we're just mindful with our intentions and our actions and how we perceive our relationship with all of that, how we perceive our traumas in the past, that is when we start to find ultimate healing. And in healing, that is when DNA is activated. That is when we're able to heal all of those old things that no longer serve us. We're able to just let them go and become our best self, our newest, most greatest potential, you know, the person we knew that we came in to be. And I know that a lot of people deal with, like, why can't I be my truest potential? And that's been, you know, for decades, that's been a hang up for a lot of people. Like, why can't I just live to what I know I'm supposed to be? And I think that, like you said, it's happening now. The Gaia is waking up. The divine feminine is awakening. And within us, each individual, whether you're masculine or feminine, born in a masculine or feminine body, we all have that divine feminine awakening, and it's merging and alchemizing with that divine masculine. And both of them are, you know, rising up, like you said, the Gaia Sophia, the Christed energy of each individual changing from carbon to crystalline. We are all in that journey together. And then this dark night of the soul, I think everyone's going through collectively
right now.
Like, you know, like you didn't even want to go to the grocery store. Like, you stayed at home, you isolated. Yeah. There are a lot of things that are happening that people are, that didn't go through it in their individual experiences, are actually going through in a collective level right now. Yeah.
And that's where the Bible, I'm not religious, but I call it the playbook. That's where the playbook comes in. In Revelations, it says 144,000 light workers are going to descend to earth and help humanity.
We're here.
Is it showtime? Like,
it's
I'm not saying I'm I'm not saying I am a light worker. I don't carry labels, titles, because those are kind of like anchors. Like, so I say I am that I am, because I asked my mom, "Mom, where did my name come from?" This was in the beginning of my awakening, because I knew I wasn't me. I knew I wasn't Brandon Avalon. I was like, "What? Who the hell am I?" And I was like, "Mom, where did my name come from?" She goes, "I made it up out of thin air. I liked it so much, I made it up." "Mom, you're telling me my name is make-believe?" And she said, "Yeah." I was like, "But you could touch me, Mom. You can't touch my name. Therefore, it's not real, but I'm real. But my name's not." And she's like, "Yeah, that kind of makes sense, Brandon." I was like, "Exactly, Mom. So who was I before this body?" And she's like, "I don't know." I was like, "But I do, because I have all these memories of all these past lives of being gas, being stars, being a plant, being an animal, being black, being a woman, being white, being a kid, being this, being every race, being a Knights Templar, being a royal family, being a slave." Like, and it all just came into my cellular memory all at once. And that's when I thought I was going crazy. Because when you start awakening in the ascension symptoms.
Yeah, that's when you realize that, like, there's no reason to divide by race or religion or culture or sexism or any of that, ageism, because we understand that we have been everything, you know?
Exactly. And
come to that realization, all of that falls away. You just don't see race anymore. You just don't see, you know, masculine, feminine. You don't see religion. I study all religions so I can put the pieces together, you know?
Yeah, it's a puzzle. It's a big puzzle.
What's this language saying? What's this language saying? What's that language saying? Yeah, I'm putting it all together like a puzzle.
I love entomology.
Yeah, that's what we're doing here, and that's, you know, what tea time is all about. So, you know, I'd love to hear any closing thoughts before we go into words of wisdom.
Closing thoughts. So, my entire life, my entire military career, I was always told that you have so much potential, but you lack a little of this or you lack a little of that. Because I wasn't seeing the potential inside myself. I wasn't given the opportunities to exploit that full potential until I went into organizations throughout the government that were able to exploit those potentials. But never allow someone that outside of you to tell you what you're worth. You came into this world 100, and you're going to leave this world 100, or at least this conscious resonance in the third dimension.
Yeah.
Everything that has ever happened to you is the culmination of greatness, because you are nothing less than greatness. Because if you were not great, you would not exist. You would not be recording this life in the eyes of you, the conscious beholder. And always remember that you were divine and you came from the spark of creation itself. Bam.
Yes. Absolutely. You know, and as you realize that, it's a level up. You know, it's like you're going to the next level of the game. When you start to realize you are a way shower, you are a trailblazer, you are one of those people that is here to break out of the box, to show what other people what it's like to live in a different way, to show other people that it's possible. And not only is it possible, but you can be very successful in so many ways. And abundance is around us. No matter how much you think there's lack, there is so much abundance and there's so much potential around us. Like you said, you come in 100 and you go out 100. And
learning.
When we go out, it's we're gonna retain our consciousness and continue, because energy can't, you know, die. It just is transformed. And I think that's what we're going through at this time, is this major transformation, going into that butterfly chrysalis and emerging with a greater purpose, a greater being that takes up much more energetic space, like a butterfly. It turns from a tiny caterpillar to a much larger being that is able to encompass much more. And that's like the ascended master, you know, where
and we're fly.
Turn into the avatar to where we're able to look down upon situations to see them for not just being wrong or right or, you know, this way or that way. We're able to see all of the different aspects of what's going on. We're able to say, oh, wow, this person is hurting because they're hurt. Oh, wow, this is a situation that's happening because there's, you know, this door is closing because this one's opening. And when you start to realize those greater awarenesses, that's when the magic happens. That's when we're able to just really level up and activate the next, what are they
stage.
Called? Like, yeah, stages, the next tokens, the next abilities, you know, and in like video games, when you level up, you get new powers, you unlock new doors or new lands, right? It opens up new pathways in the maps or however that works, but it something happens to where you access more of reality, more of that game land. So as we're doing this, we're accessing more of this game land and we're understanding more how to play. And in that we're, you know, able to show each other how to do it as well.
And in all reality, and we can break it all the way down to the minutest level, it's opening up new neural pathways, new neural synapsisness in the human brain, which you're building a bridge between the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere of the brain, because it's supposed to be separate. And when you open up new doors with new keys through the healing, dealing with the trauma, you build the bridge. It's called the Antakahana. And when you build that bridge, you walk across it and you accept the full embodiment of your higher self. Whoever your higher self is, who are you? Where did you come before you were here? Do you remember? Do you want to remember? Are you 100% sure you want to? Because that's a rabbit hole. That's a rabbit hole not a lot can handle.
There's a reason why we forgot. Yeah, and in remembering it, you have to have a certain consciousness to forgive all those things that you did in past lives. And I think that's, you know, that's part of where we forget. And you know, it's we have this certain journey and this certain ego that we need to explore first for a little bit before we do release those certain shackles that keep us bound in these identities. And, you know, like I was talking about earlier before the show, it's like my husband and I were talking about identity and, you know, how identity is essentially only what other people call you. So, you know, like for him, he's dad, he's Todd, he's a son, he's a friend, he's bro. His one friend calls him Tap. He's like all these different names, you know, like literally all these different names, but he doesn't identify as those names individually because he's a soul, you know, he's who he is. And that's the same thing for many names and many different, you know, characters that I play in life. But ultimately, we are all, you know, the same. We're all this divine essence that connects us. That's that web that interconnects us all. And that in the microcosm, we make up God. We are that ultimate universe, that the fragmented, you know, like you said, you're a fragment of God, you know, the I am that I am. We all are the I am that I am. And, you know, I love
it's just coming to the recognition of it.
What was that?
It's just coming to the self-recognition of it.
It is, yeah. And so I would love for you to go into words of wisdom to close out the show that you'd like to share. Like,
okay, well, by Dr. Chill, I am energy from before being to after becoming. I am free. Death cannot stop the quantum me. As I return to the stars of we, universe, I am whole. Love, a soul love, a heart love, a mind love, a body love, unfettered by social conventions, I am.
Definitely so much truth in that. You spill the tea all over the place with that one. The truth is out. I really connect with that quote, that words of wisdom's full of so much inspiration, because as we start to realize all of those divine inspirations, that's when we just start to understand how interconnected we all are and how it interplays with each other. So I really appreciate that words of wisdom and how that, you know, closed up the show and really put it all together. And definitely going to do another show in the future. Oh, yeah. Quantum healing and all the good stuff that we kind of touched on a little bit in this show today. You are definitely a divine light that I really appreciate sharing your story.
Thank you.
And sharing your wisdom with this world. A way shower, a trailblazer, definitely appreciate everything that you share on your Facebook and on your YouTube. If people want to find you, can you share your links of how to find you on your social media?
Yeah, it's it's Brandon Avolin, which is my name, 2.0 on YouTube. My last name spell is A-V as in Victor, O-L-I-N. And then on Facebook, it's just Brandon Avolin.
Great. So check out Brandon Avolin on his YouTube. Subscribe to his YouTube. Check out a bunch of the videos. They're super inspiring. And connect with him on Facebook if you feel inspired. Give a big thumbs up to this show. If you enjoyed this video, share it with your friends on social media. And remember to subscribe for free to Wildcraft Wellness and hit the little notifications gear. Subscribe also to Brandon Avolin on his YouTube, and stay tuned for all of the newest videos to come. We absolutely love sharing conscious conversation with you guys, and I really appreciate you sharing a cup with me today, Brandon. Cheers.
Thank you.
And I look forward to talking again.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Blessings. Thank you so much for your time.
Ciao.